instinct and sentiment. One point, however, I may insist on. All trickery, all deception, is certain to be discovered and to result in doing harm. Whereas every situation presents less danger if a man plants himself firmly on his own truthfulness. If I may cite my own case, I can tell you that, obliged as I am by Monsieur de Mortsauf's condition to avoid litigation and to bring to an immediate settlement all difficulties which arise in the management of Clochegourde, and which would otherwise cause him an excitement under which his mind would succumb, I have invariably settled matters promptly by taking hold of the knot of the difficulty and saying to our opponents, we will either untie it or cut it. Quote, it will often happen that you do a service to others and find yourself ill rewarded. I beg you not to imitate those who complain of men and declare them to be all ungrateful. That is putting themselves on a pedestal indeed. And surely it is somewhat silly to admit their lack of knowledge of the world. But you, I trust, will not do good as a usurer lends his money. You will do it, will you not? For good sake, noblesse oblige. Nevertheless, do not bestow such services as to force others to ingratitude, for if you do, they will become your most implacable enemies. Obligations sometimes lead to despair, like the despair of ruin itself, which is capable of very desperate efforts. As for yourself, accept as little as you can from others. Be no man's vassal, and bring yourself out of your own difficulties. You see, dear friend, I am advising you only on the lesser points of life. In the world of politics, things wear a different aspect. The rules which are to guide your individual steps give way before the national interests. If you reach that sphere where great men revolve, you will be, like God himself, the sole arbiter of your determinations. You will no longer be a man, but law, the living law. No longer an individual, you are then the nation incarnate. But remember this, though you judge, you will yourself be judged. Hereafter you will be summoned before the ages, and you know history well enough to be fully informed as to what deeds and what sentiments have led to true grandeur. I now come to a serious matter, your conduct towards women. Wherever you visit, make it a principle not to fritter yourself away in a petty round of gallantry. A man of the last century who had great social success never paid attention to more than one woman of an evening, choosing the one who seemed the most neglected. That man, my dear child, controlled his epoch. He wisely reckoned that by a given time all women would speak well of him. Many young men waste their most precious possession, namely, the time necessary to create connections which contribute more than all else to social success. Your springtime is short, endeavor to make the most of it. Cultivate influential women. Influential women are old women. They will teach you the intermarriages and the secrets of all the families of the great world. They will show you the crossroads which will bring you soonest to your goal. They will be fond of you. The bestowal of protection is their last form of love when they are not devout. They will do you innumerable good services. Sing your praises and make you desirable to society. Avoid young women. Do not think I say this from personal self-interest. The woman of 50 will do all for you, the woman of 20 will do nothing. She wants your whole life while the other asks only a few attentions. Laugh with the young women, meet them for pastime merely. They are incapable of serious thought. Young women, dear friend, are selfish, vain, petty, ignorant of true friendship. They love no one but themselves. They would sacrifice you to an evening's success. Besides, they all want absolute devotion, and your present situation requires that devotion be shown to you. Two irreconcilable needs. None of these young women would enter into your interests. They would think of themselves and not of you. They would injure you more by their emptiness and frivolity than they could serve you by their love. They will waste your time unscrupulously, hinder your advance to fortune, and end by destroying your future with the best grace possible. If you complain, the silliest of them will make you think that her glove is more precious than fortune, and that nothing is so glorious as to be her slave. They will all tell you that they bestow happiness, and thus lull you to forget your nobler destiny. Believe me, the happiness they give is transitory. Your great career will endure. You know not with what perfidious cleverness they contrive to satisfy their caprices, nor the art with which they will convert your passing fancy into a love which ought to be eternal. The day when they abandon you, they will tell you that the words, I no longer love you, are a full justification of their conduct, just as the words, I love, justify their winning you. They will declare that love is involuntary and not to be coerced. Absurd. Believe me, dear, true love is eternal, infinite, always like unto itself. It is equitable, pure, without violent demonstration. White hair often covers the head, but the heart that holds it is ever young. No such love is found among the women of the world. All are playing comedy. This one will interest you by her misfortunes. She seems the gentlest and least exacting of her sex, but when once she is necessary to you, you will feel the tyranny of weakness and will do her will. You may wish to be a diplomat, to go and come, and study men and interests. No, you must stay in Paris, or at her country place, sewn to her petticoat, and the more devotion you show, the more ungrateful and exacting she will be. Another will attract you by her submissiveness. She will be your attendant, follow you romantically about, compromise herself to keep you, and be the millstone about your neck. You will drown yourself someday, but the woman will come to the surface. The least maneuvering of these women of the world have many nets. The silliest triumph because too foolish to excite distrust. The one to be feared least may be the woman of gallantry whom you love without exactly knowing why. She will leave you for no motive and go back to you out of vanity. All these women will injure you, either in the present or the future. Every young woman who enters society and lives a life of pleasure and of gratified vanity is semi-corrupt and will corrupt you. Among them you will not find the chaste and tranquil being in whom you may forever reign. Ah! She who loves you will love solitude. The festivals of her heart will be your glances. She will live upon your words. May she be all the world to you, for you will be all in all to her. Love her well. Give her neither griefs nor rivals. Do not rouse her jealousy. To be loved, dear, to be comprehended, is the greatest of all joys. I pray that you may taste it. But run no risk of injuring the flower of your soul. Be sure, be very sure of the heart in which you place your affections. That woman will never be her own self. She will never think of herself but of you. She will never oppose you, she will have no interests of her own. For you she will see a danger where you can see none and where she would be oblivious of her own. If she suffers it will be in silence. She will have no personal vanity, but deep reverence for whatever in her has won your love. Respond to such a love by surpassing it. If you are fortunate enough to find that which I, you poor friend, must ever be without. I mean a love mutually inspired, mutually felt. Remember that in a valley lives a mother whose heart is so filled with the feelings you have put there that you can never sound its depths. Yes, I bear you an affection which you will never know to its full extent. Before it could show itself for what it is, you would have to lose your mind and intellect, and then you would be unable to comprehend the length and breadth of my devotion. Shall I be misunderstood in bidding you avoid young women? All more or less artful, satirical, vain, frivolous, and extravagant. And attach yourself to influential women. To those imposing dowagers full of excellent good sense, like my aunt, who will help your career, defend you from attacks, and say for you the things that you cannot say for yourself. Am I not, on the contrary, generous in bidding you reserve your love for the coming angel with a guileless heart? If the motto Noblesse oblige sums up the advice I gave you just now, my further advice on your relations to women is based upon that other motto of chivalry, serve all, love one. Quote, your educational knowledge is immense. Your heart, saved by early suffering, is without a stain. All is noble, all is well with you. Now, Felix Will. Your future lies in that one word, that word of great men. My child, you will obey your Henriette, will you not? You'll permit her to tell you from time to time the thoughts that are in her mind of you and of your relations to the world. I have an eye in my soul which sees the future for you as for my children. Suffer me to use that faculty for your benefit. It is a faculty, a mysterious gift bestowed by my lonely life. Far from its growing weaker, I find it strengthened and exalted by solitude and silence. I ask you in return to bestow a happiness on me. I desire to see you becoming more and more important among men, without one single success that shall bring a line of shame upon my brow. I desire that you may quickly bring your fortunes to the level of your noble name, and be able to tell me I have contributed to your advancement by something better than a wish. This secret cooperation in your future is the only pleasure I can allow myself. For it, I will wait and hope.